I'm saved by grace, and you know, Jesus is the one that saves. Let's go to number 281. We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Let's all stand together as we sing. 281. On that first all together. We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Climb the steeps and cross the waves. Onward is our Lord's command. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Wafted on the rolling tide. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Tell to sinners far and wide. Jesus saves. Sing ye island of the seas, echo back ye ocean caves, earth shall keep her jubilee. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. On that last, give the winds a mighty voice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let the nations now rejoice. Jesus saves.
Good singing this morning. Good to see you in church today, and looking forward to a great service here this morning. Hope you had a good day yesterday, and we missed out on our hayride last night and bonfire. A little soggy from the other 3 days, but I want to talk to Brother Shane and Michelle, see if we can fit another date in sometime here in the month of October, all right? And it fills up quickly, and things going on. But as soon as we can nail down a time, we'll let you know. But that's always a great time. And we missed out on that last night. But looking forward to maybe doing something in the future. But it's glad you made it out today. Looking forward to what God's going to do here in our midst this morning. Let's start with a word of prayer, shall we? Father in heaven, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you, Lord, for another Lord's Day you brought us to. And Lord, thank you for what we just sang about, that we're glad we heard the joyful sound, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. And Lord, if there's anyone in the room today that has never experienced that, they could not testify personally that they know Jesus saves, that they would experience that this morning. They would receive him as their personal Savior. May you be pleased with our service today. May Christ be exalted. May he be lifted up, and may you draw all of us closer to him because we were in church this morning. Lord, please speak to our hearts today as only you can do. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
I'm glad Jesus came. Glory to his name. Oh, what a friend is he. He so freely gave his own life to take from others' sins set free.
Nobody knows what it means to me. Nobody.
shall humbly to him bow, just let the Lord come in. You'll find perfect peace, joy shall never cease, he'll do the same for you.
I've got that time religion in
love in my heart,
ways down and shine. I've got that new kind of feeling in my heart.
Nobody knows but my Lord and me.
I've got that old time religion in my heart, way down inside.
Amen. 268, 268. I will sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me. 268. We're going to sing that first, third, and last together. On that first,
I will sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross he suffered from the curse to set me free. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with his blood he purchased me. On the cross dead and made me free. I will praise my dear Redeemer, his triumphant power I'll tell, how the victory he given over sin and death and hell. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, he paid the debt and made me free. I will sing of my Redeemer and his heavenly love to me. He from death to life hath brought me, Son of God with him to be. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free.
All right, a few announcements for us now. We have our regular schedule today. 5:30 for our Christian growth class, and tonight's lesson is going to be on the last days, and we'll be discussing that. 5:30 for the Christian growth class, meets in the conference room right down across from our nursery. And then 6:30 tonight for the evening service, how do I handle stumbling blocks? Everybody's going to have to deal with a stumbling block in your Christian walk, in the race you run. How are you going to handle those, and how are you going to not let them be a stumbling block, but maybe make it a stepping stone? And we'll give you some help with that this evening, how to handle the stumbling blocks. Now, ladies, you have a ladies' night out October the 10th. There's a sign-up sheet for that downstairs. That's your fall ladies' meeting, and you're going to be doing, it says here in the bulletin, an easy, fun, DIY is do-it-yourself project, okay? It's very practical and versatile craft for your home with a variety of uses. Sounds like a husband. And enjoy an evening of fun, food, and fellowship, all right? That's, I think, 6:30 on Monday, October the 10th. There's a sign-up sheet for that downstairs. Then 2 weeks from today is our old-fashioned Sunday, all right? That's always a great day. We're an old-fashioned, independent, Bible-believing Baptist church. Make no bones about it. That's just what we are, and glad to be so. But one time a year, we really put our stamp of approval on the old-time religion, and we dress the part, and so folks will dress in their old-fashioned Sunday go-to-meeting clothes, and auditorium will be decorated with old-fashioned decor. We'll have a dinner on the grounds afterwards, and there's a sign-up sheet for that downstairs, and so plan to be part of it on that big day. I think we have sack races in the afternoon for the children, And for some of you adults that are still children, and we'll have a good time together on Old Fashioned Sunday coming up October the 16th. All right? Okay, that's all I have right now. Let's take just a moment, and we'll welcome our guests that are with us today. If you're visiting here this morning, we'd love to meet you, find out who you are and where you're from. Anybody here today for the very first time? Just put your hand up in the air. Anybody at all? Everybody's been here at least once? You got a couple right here? Okay, good. Who are you and where are you from? Great. Good to have you this morning. Thank you to the McEwens. Good. Thank you for being here. Usher's going to hand you a card to fill out. If you'll be kind enough to fill the card out. In a little bit, we have the offering, and if you just drop that card in the plate, then we'll have a record of your visit with us this morning. All right? Thank you for being here. That's great. All right? Let's give the McEwen family a warm welcome, shall we?
463, would you turn with me, please? When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. On that verse together, 463. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder. is called up yonder, when the roar is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. As we sing this last verse, children, you're dismissed to junior church. Children, dismissed to junior church. On that last, let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all His wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Amen. Great singing this morning. Let's go over to 523-523. I sought a flag to follow. When you find that, if you stand with me, 523. On that first, I sought a flag to follow, a cause for which to stand. I sought a valiant leader who could my love command. I sought a stirring challenge, some noble work to try, to give my life fulfillment, my dreams to satisfy. I found them all in Jesus, the truth, the way. Beneath this flag I'll take my stand and follow Him today. I sought a ringing answer for all my doubts inside, a torch of truth uplifted, my searching steps to guide. I sought a word of wisdom, authority. I sought to know life's purpose, to solve its mystery. I found them all in Jesus, the life, the truth, the way. Beneath this flag I'll take my stand and follow Him today. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you.
I found them all in Jesus, the life, the truth, the way. Beneath his flag I'll take my stand and follow him today.
As you find your seats, let's sing that last together. I sought for satisfaction, for yearning deep within. On that last together,
I sought for satisfaction, for yearning deep within. I sought for full deliverance from chains of guilt and sin. I sought for peace and pardon, for freedom from my fears. I sought a hope to cling to beyond these passing years. I found them all in Jesus, the life, the truth, the way. Beneath his flag I'll take my stand and follow him today.
Everybody said amen. Amen. Good singing this morning. You be seated. And time for the offering. Amen. And everybody said, amen. That's good, that's good. I believe you. And amen. Give as the Lord has blessed you and prospered you through the week. And give cheerfully. Remember your faith promise commitment to the Lord through missions. And keep that up throughout the year, all right? Let's pray and we'll ask God's blessing on our offering this morning. Brother Polebo, I'd like you to lead us, if you would, please.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us and this church that you brought raised up here with the pastor. We ask that you'd bless him today, give him the right words to say. And if there's one here that does not know you as Lord and Savior, they'll get that taken care of before they leave the building. And we pray that you'd bless the offering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Take your Bible this morning for our scripture reading, if you would, please, to Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9 for our scripture reading. We're going to read the first 9 verses of Acts chapter 9. Read the verses responsively. We begin together on verse 1, then I'll read 2. We alternate like that until we end together on verse 9 of Acts chapter 9. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. Let's begin together on verse 1. Ready? And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest. and desired of him letters to Damascus to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth, and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, Arise, and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do. And the men which journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. And Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man. But they led him by the hand, and brought him into Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight, and neither did eat nor drink. And let's pray, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of the scripture here this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the Bible. And thank you, God, for preserving your word, that we hold copies of it in our hand this morning. And Lord, I pray that you would continue to prepare our hearts, and we'll be ready to receive the truth from your word this morning. Bless the special now. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Bethlehem, Calvary, all of that town. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Mountain and plain with his praises shall swell. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Savior, oh, what a Savior is mine. Unto the uttermost, wonderful, glorious, oh, what a Savior is mine. There on that cross where he died for my sin. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Giving his life a poor wonder to win. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Unto the uttermost, wonderful, glorious. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Rising again in his infinite grace. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Shedding upon me the light of his face. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Lifting my burdens, relieving my care. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Giving me courage to do and to tear. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Would you sing? sing that chorus with me? Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Unto the uttermost, wonderful, glorious. Oh, what a Savior is mine.
Amen. That's good. I'm glad he had you join in, because I was going to anyway. Amen. Oh, that's great. I love that song. And that kind of sticks with you. You'll be going somewhere tomorrow, and it's going to come right to you, and you're going to start singing, "Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior." Oh, and you'll shut the radio off, and you'll just be singing away. And at least that's how it works in my car anyway. And praise the Lord. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for the wonderful Savior that Jesus Christ is to us. Lord, it sure is. It's been good to be in church this morning. And thank you for each one that's made their way here. Now, Father, we bow before you as we open up your word today. And Lord, we want to receive the truth that you have for us this morning. And God, I pray that you would help each one listening now to focus, to concentrate, to ask you to put a hedge round about us. Well, don't let our mind wander. Don't let us be caught looking at other things, thinking of other things, and miss what you have for us this morning. Help me as I bring this message today, and please, please help each one as they listen. May none of us miss what you have for us this morning. Give us all ears to hear what the Spirit would say to his church this morning. And I'll thank you for it, for I ask it for Jesus' sake. Amen. Here in Acts chapter 9, if your Bible's still open there, you find the account of the salvation experience, if you will, of the Apostle Paul. He was Saul then. He'll later become Paul. Without a doubt, I think probably the most unique salvation experience that is recorded in the Bible. You never see anything else like it in Scripture. That on my knowledge, nobody else had this kind of experience. And you know, we all realize there's only one way to go to heaven. That's by faith in Jesus Christ. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." There isn't many ways, many roads that lead to heaven. No, there's only one road that leads to heaven, and Jesus is that road. There's not a Baptist way to heaven. There's not a Catholic way to heaven. There's not a Presbyterian way to heaven. There's not a Lutheran way to heaven. There's only the Bible way to heaven, and that's Jesus Christ, all right? Now, that being said, there are innumerable ways. There's as many ways to come to Jesus as there are people on the planet, all right? Everybody has a unique testimony, a unique way that the Lord brought you to put your faith in Jesus Christ. But nobody ever had a testimony like Saul. Nobody ever said, "Well, a bright light shined from heaven, and it was above the light of the sun, and I heard the voice of Jesus himself speak to me, and so I trusted him as my Savior." Now, Saul would become Paul, and he's going to write half the New Testament. He's going to be a great missionary, a great church planner, a great soul winner. He was an amazing Christian. But we tend, if we're not careful, we can tend to look at people like Paul and think they were some superhuman being. Or they were some super Christian of some sort. And listen, these were men and women just like us. That's why I think the Bible reminds us over in the book of James about Elijah. Remember when James was talking about prayer and he said Elijah prayed that it wouldn't rain? And it didn't rain for 3 years and 6 months. No rain on the earth. And he said, but lest we start thinking Elijah was some unbelievable person, he says, hey, he was a man subject to like passions just like you. God is saying he wasn't anything. He was made of the same stuff you and I are made of. We're no different. And just as God said, I can use Saul and I could use an Elisha, and God certainly had a plan for Saul here to become a missionary, to become a church planner. And I thought about this, Brother Morton, to become a Bible translator, because that's what Paul was. He said, I had a plan for Paul. Listen, he also has a plan for your life and for my life. Don't read about this conversion of Saul and you find out that God had a plan for him to do something and say, well, man, that's great for Paul. I'm glad God used him. I'm glad God did all that he did with Paul. But would God do anything for me? And the answer is yes. The same desire that God had for Paul, the same plan that God had for Paul, God has a plan for your life. Nobody surprised God when you got saved. When you put your faith in Jesus Christ, God didn't say, oh, wow, didn't see that coming. He didn't say that. He knew exactly you were going to get saved, and he knew what he wanted you to do with your life. Now, and by the way, not only does God have a plan for your life, God deserves your life. We have been bought with a price. We have been purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ when he died on the cross. And so, as Romans tells us, to give my life back to God is my reasonable service. That's the only reasonable thing to do, is to let God do what he wants with my life. And so I want to encourage you today. I'm preaching on this subject. Can God use me? Can God use me? And what hinders people from believing that God can use them? I talk to people all the time that they love to read the stories of the Bible. They love to read how God did things with people in the Bible, but they really don't believe God would ever use them to do anything. And I want to encourage you today that God wants to use you. Now, there's several obstacles that you may think is keeping God from using you. And I want to remove those obstacles out of the road this morning, all right? And so, listen carefully. For some people, it's their past that is the obstacle that keeps them from serving God. I want you to look at 1 Timothy chapter 3. Would you look there with me for a moment, please? 1 Timothy chapter 3. And I think it's chapter 1 myself. Yes, 1 Timothy chapter 1. I'll have to talk to that person who writes my notes and make sure I straighten them out. 1 Timothy chapter 1. Notice with me in verse 13. Who was before a blasphemer and a persecutor and injurious. But I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceeding abundant with faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus. Paul's talking about being put into the ministry here, and he talks about what he was before. He talks about his past. And guess what he said he was? I was a blasphemer. I was a persecutor. I was injurious. In chapter 9, it says he was breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the people of God. That's quite a past, my friend, that Saul was dealing with. You remember he stood by and approved the stoning of Stephen. But listen, when God reached down this day on the road to Damascus and saved the man named Saul, I got news for you, my friend. His past was all forgiven. His past all became the past. And it was no longer remembered by God. It became obsolete. Past sins, past failures, past deeds, all of it has been washed away. He got a new birth. He got a new beginning. He got a new start. He got a new slate. He was clean altogether. People get plagued by their past. And there's three sources for that. Number one is your own memory. You carry it around in your mind. You carry it around in your mind, and you continue to remind yourself of your failures. The second source of our past being an obstacle is other people. There are other people who knew you in the past. They knew what you were like. And they're all too quick to remind you of what you were instead of what you are. And they like to tell you what you were before you were forgiven. And then, of course, the third source of our past is Satan himself. He's the accuser of the brethren. And he is more than happy to bring up your past and throw it in your face. And so we understand that, and by the way, everybody has a past. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from most unrighteousness. Oh, I didn't say that right, did I? Well, certainly, not most, not some, all. Does that include the past? Well, certainly it does. And God says, I've forgiven that, I've cleansed that, I've whipped it clean. You may remember the past, others may remember the past, Satan will remember your past, but hey, I got good news for you this morning. God doesn't remember the past. It's forgiven, it's gone, it's as if it never happened. That's great news. Your sins and your iniquities, God says, will I remember no more. God says your past is no obstacle for me using you in the future. Think about this. Moses murdered a man. Joseph had a criminal record. Abraham lied twice about Sarah, but he was called the friend of God. David committed both the sin of adultery and murder, yet God said he's a man after my own heart. Peter cursed and swore, and he denied he even knew the Lord. Think about this. Less than 2 months later, 50 days later, just about exactly, 53 days maybe after counting the resurrection. He's preaching. Do you think, and he's preaching in Jerusalem, where Jesus was crucified, where he cursed and swore and denied he even knew who he was. You got to believe, you think Peter ever thought, I wonder if any of these people here heard me swearing 53 days ago? Denying that I even knew who Jesus was? Talk about somebody who had to be convinced my past is gone. Peter had to understand that. My past won't be an obstacle to God using me in the future. Your past can't be an obstacle. 3,000 folks were saved that day on Pentecost and added to the church. What am I saying? Listen to me. Your past is not an obstacle for God using you. Let me give you a second obstacle that people deal with in thinking God won't use them. That's their current circumstances. Your current circumstances. Here's Saul. Verse 2, it talks about in verse 1, he's breathing out the threatenings and the slaughter. Verse 2, he desired letters to Damascus, to the synagogues. He got these letters from the high priest that he found any of this way. That's how they referred to Christians. This way. It's Christianity. Listen, Christianity isn't just a belief system. It's a way of life. It's a way we live. Okay? So this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. He was there to hunt down Christians, persecute them, bring them back as prisoners, and if need be, kill them. And it was on that trip, during those circumstances of his life, that God reached down and saved his soul. Paul, as we mentioned, stood by Stephen when he was stoned. When the Lord said later on, he said, it's hard for you to kick against the pricks. I believe that's the pricking of his conscience. Stephen, the Bible says, when they began to stone Stephen, they were so mad at him and so angry with his message of Jesus Christ, they stoned him. And the Bible says he had the face, and his face was as the face of an angel. I don't think Saul ever got over that. Looking at Stephen and watching him face death, such a heavenly countenance, such a holy presence about him. His words were so powerful that day. I believe Stephen's sermon there in Acts 7, I think it was so powerful and so convicting to the men who were listening. such a humble man. Stephen never cared about the approval of the world. And it was obvious he had no fear of death. It all exposed the emptiness that Saul had in his heart, that he was experiencing. He was a devoted Pharisee. He was a student of the Old Testament scriptures. But you see, to that point in his life, Saul had never come up against, face to face, a fully surrendered Christian. Stephen was the first one. And he never got it out of his mind. He couldn't get it out of his heart. He looked at him, and I wonder if he thought, I've trained for years reading the scriptures. Yet this unlearned man, Stephen didn't have any formal training. But boy, you read Acts 7, it's full of scripture. It's full of the history of Israel. And I'm sure he thought, man, where'd this guy learn this stuff? How can he talk this way? I wonder if he thought in his heart, if Saul thought, I know about God. But this guy, he knows God. He knows Him. I don't have what this guy has. And that day, as he hears the voice from heaven, he says, Who is it that's talking to me? And he says, I'm Jesus whom thou persecutest. I wonder, in the Bible it seems like it just is rapid fire. Who art thou, Lord? I'm Jesus. What wilt thou have me to do? I think time took place during this time. I don't think it took place in a few seconds like we're reading it. I wonder, as he heard the name Jesus, listen, that had to sink in a little bit. He didn't believe in Jesus. He didn't believe that He was the Messiah. He didn't believe He was God. I wonder how long Paul was there and maybe weeping. I thought about this when Brother Jarvis talked about his testimony, how he had been a Jehovah's Witness before the Lord saved him. And how he listened to those tapes that someone had given him. This is back when some of you young people are looking at me like, a tape? What's a tape? It's a cassette tape. Ask your parents about it later. And he would listen to these things and how, hey, listen for an hour, I think almost an hour and a half, and he had no rebuttals written down on his paper. And he said the overwhelming sense on him, coming over him, I'm wrong. For 31 years, I've been wrong. I believed a lie. I wonder if Saul had that come over him, where he realized, I'm wrong. I've been going about this thinking I'm serving God. I'm not serving God. I've been opposed to God. Boy, that overwhelming feeling come on him, and he fell to his knees. I could see him beginning to weep. Then he said, Lord. Now he knows he's talking to Jesus. And he calls Jesus Lord. When a Jewish man calls Jesus Lord, something's happened. He's been born again. And he says, now, what do you have for me to do? What do you have for me to do? What a dramatic, dramatic salvation experience. And of course, the Lord told him to go into the city, and it's going to be told him what he could do. Everybody has circumstances in life that they think, I can't serve God now. Oh, no, preacher, I'm not saying I'm not going to serve God. I'm going to serve Him. I just can't do it right now. My finances aren't quite right. I don't quite have the education. Well, there's my children. I think I need to just grow in my faith some more. Let me tell you about Clyde Thompson. Clyde Thompson, his father was a Bible salesman, but when Clyde was old enough to stay home alone, he began to refuse to go to church with the rest of the family. While most of his family went to church, Clyde would go hunting. One Sunday afternoon in 1929, he was 17 years old, and he met some men in the woods, and for some reason, Clyde killed those men. At the age of 17, he was the youngest man in Texas history to be sentenced to death in the electric chair. 2 years later, as the date of his execution neared, Clyde listened to a radio preacher. And he asked for that man to come to prison and baptize him. The preacher came and Clyde was baptized, and legal complications kept him from being executed. But things began to go very badly for him, and he was worked so hard at the prison farm, he lost his faith. He began trying to escape. A number of prisoners were killed while trying to escape with Clyde. Clyde was shot through the shoulder in one of the attempts. While on death row, he got into a fight and he killed two other prisoners, making a total of four now that he's killed. As the years passed, Clyde Thompson was tagged by his own prison inmates as the meanest man in the state of Texas. He developed such a terrible reputation inside death row, they put him in isolation. They put him in an old building, used to be the morgue. A steel door was put in place. The only opening was about a foot square with bars on it. No running water, no electricity. Because the morgue sat between two very tall buildings inside the prison, you'd only have daylight come through that square hole for about 6 hours a day. After being isolated there for 2 or 3 months, Clyde asked a guard if he'd bring him a Bible. They wouldn't give him anything else to read, but he was bored, so he wanted something to read, and he decided he'd try to prove the Bible wasn't from God. He would try to prove that the Bible was full of contradictions. That's what he'd been told anyway. But as he began to read, and the more he studied, the more he became convinced that it was God's truth. He became to realize that Christianity was the only hope. And in that solitary confinement, in that converted morgue of a place all by himself, he fell on his knees and repented in tears and asked Christ to be his Savior. He kept reading the Bible for day and night for months and kept asking God to forgive him for what he'd done. But a change came over Clyde Thompson. The guards noticed it. Later, he was released from the morgue to return to death row, but on death row, he began to teach men the Bible. He baptized by immersion 8 other prisoners. He made such an impression on the prison administration, they finally released him from death row and put him in with the general population, where he continued to study his Bible. He took a 2-year Bible course from a college in Tennessee. He became the chaplain's right-hand man, his assistant. And eventually, after more than 28 years in prison, the state of Texas gave him a lifetime parole. On the outside, Clyde went straight to the Lubbock County Jail, one of the largest county jails in Texas, and he began a chaplaincy program there. Clyde died of a heart attack in July of 1979. But it was Clyde Thompson who go down in God's record book as one of the greatest soul winners of his generation. It was Clyde Thompson, known as the meanest man in the state of Texas, who led hundreds of men, women, boys, and girls out of alcoholism, out of drugs, and to the foot of the cross of Jesus Christ. The meanest man in the state of Texas, transformed when he allowed the Word of God to take hold of his life. When he simply said, I don't care about my circumstances. I know where I am. I'm in the prison. I'm in here by my own doing, but I'm not going to let my present circumstances keep God from using me. And God used him in a great way. So many are like Moses. You begin to make excuses when God touches your heart about doing something for him. Moses began to make excuses to God. Can I remind you, Moses was 80. Oh, preacher, I'm too old to do something for God now. Are you past 80? Moses had a murder in his past. Backside of the desert is where he was. Why was he on the backside of the desert? Because no one would know where he was. Not only backside of the desert, but tending sheep. That was a safe thing because that's an abomination to the Egyptians. They weren't going to go looking for him. But he had to work for his father-in-law. That had to be rough. There he was. Peter was no different after denying Christ and returning to fishing. He went back to fishing. He said, I go a fishing, and that is a continual sense. I'm going back to fishing. That's what he was before he followed Christ. Jesus had to appear to him on that shore and set things straight. Never, by the way, never did bring up. If that had been you and me, what's the first thing we'd ask Peter? What were you doing? What were you thinking? You said you'd never deny me. You said everybody would forsake me, but you never would. Remember what you said? Boy, we'd have thrown it all up in his face. Jesus didn't do any of that. He just looked at the fish, looked at Peter, and said, lovest thou me more than these? And listen, literally about 50 days from that point, he's preaching. He's 40 days from that point. He's leading the prayer meeting for 10 days in the upper room. And leading that early church. I mean, if anybody could have looked at it and said, well, my circumstances, boy, I've blown it, they're just not right. This isn't the right time. It's only been 50 days, God. I need more time to go by. But Jesus didn't see it that way. You see, your circumstances may have surprised you, but they haven't surprised God. Job went through some incredible things. Things that he never would have ever thought of. Job had a great life, you remember? But Job lost all of that in one day. Job, you know, what do you see happening in your life? I guarantee he said, I don't see everything being wiped out in one day. You know what Job said in Job chapter 23? He said this about the Lord. He said, he knoweth the path that I take. God knew exactly what was going to happen. We tell people all the time, those who wait on the right circumstances to get saved don't get saved. Anybody in the Bible who said, the Agrippa, almost you persuade me to be a Christian? Almost is to be lost. Festus, hey, I'll hear you again in a more convenient time. The more convenient time never came. And so we press upon people what? That now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. But then why is it that we put off our service for God with all sorts of excuses because of our circumstances? Our present circumstances. Your past should not be an obstacle. Your present circumstances are not an obstacle. Number three, your personal weaknesses are not an obstacle. When you read further on in Acts 9 about Saul, you'll find out that as he goes in and Ananias greets him, you find that the early church, the Christians and the apostles, they were afraid of Saul still. They didn't want to, they really didn't believe he really got saved. They weren't so sure about this. And listen, he wasn't impressive in stature. Saul, as far as we could tell, was not very tall. From some of the things he mentions in Scripture, he might have had some sort of an eye issue where he might have caused him to squint a lot. So there's a short, squinty guy. You know what I mean? You think of Paul as you read, you think he's this big 6'4", you know, strapping guy. I had to laugh, Brother McEwen, you know, these are folks who listen on the radio. And then they come to church and they see the guy talking on the radio and they go, oh, brother, what a disappointment this is, huh? And that's how they felt about Saul. I thought, boy, there's nothing impressive here about this guy. He's just a short fella, squinty, and you know what? God used him. God used him in a great way. David, in the Old Testament, wasn't even going to be included when Samuel came and asked Jesse to see his boys. They all passed before him, and God kept saying, nope, 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 nope. Finally, he said, is this all you got? Well, got one out with the sheep. Bring him in. I got to see him. He wasn't even going to be included. Talk about personal weaknesses. I read about Gladys Allward. As a teenager, she read a magazine article about China that changed her life. She kept thinking about the millions of people in that land who'd not yet heard about the love of God and Jesus Christ. And she knew she had to tell them. To do this, she was told she'd have to go to missionary training school. But after finishing, she was informed that she did not qualify. She failed her exams. That setback didn't derail her passion. She worked at other jobs and saved her money. And then she heard of a 73-year-old missionary, Mrs. Jeannie Lawson, who was looking for a younger woman to carry on her work. So Gladys wrote to Mrs. Lawson and was accepted if she could get to China. So on Saturday, October 15th, 1932, at age 30, Gladys Allward left Liverpool, England, bound for China. Upon her arrival there, she took up Miss Lawson's work and began learning the Chinese language, something the training school said she'd never be able to do. She began sharing the gospel in the surrounding villages. She began to take in orphans. Before long, she had 20 children under her care. Not to mention the 30 to 40 wounded soldiers she was caring for, and eventually it grew to over 100 children that she cared for. She adopted China as her homeland and became a citizen in 1936. And she did that simply because she loved the Lord Jesus and she believed that would help make her more effective in proclaiming Christ to the people. When the war reached its pinnacle in 1938, she smuggled her children out of China. It took 27 days to get them out. When they arrived in Siam, the doctors were amazed. Gladys had pneumonia, typhus, malnutrition, and exhaustion. And she recovered by the grace of God. At the end of her life, she wrote the following about herself. Quote, my heart is full of praise that one so insignificant, uneducated, and ordinary in every way could be used to His glory for the blessing of His people in poor and persecuted China. She's a great example of 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 27 that says, God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and He's chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. Regardless of who you are this morning, regardless of your weaknesses, regardless of your personality quirks, I'm telling you, God will use you. God desires to use you in His service. Don't let personal weaknesses hinder you. Don't let that be an obstacle in your life. Then finally, let me give you number four. Here's your only obstacle. Your only obstacle is absolute surrender. Absolute surrender. Really, your only obstacle is yourself. Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, as he prays about God removing a thorn in the flesh that He gave to him, Paul said these words, 2 Corinthians 12, verse number 10. He says, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. When I'm weak, then I am strong. You know what God's looking for? Weak people who will depend upon Him. Weak people who will look to God for their strength. He only could use Moses once Moses was absolutely surrendered to Him. He would only use Simon Peter when Simon Peter would be absolutely surrendered to him. He would only use Paul once Paul was absolutely surrendered to him. Preachers were discussing having D.L. Moody for a meeting. And several of the preachers were pretty adamant about having Dwight Moody, no one else. And one of the preachers was getting frustrated about it, and he said, well, what's up with this D.L. Moody? Does he have a monopoly on the Holy Spirit? And one of the preachers stood up and said, no, but it seems as if the Holy Spirit has a monopoly on him. That's what God's looking for. Men completely yielded to Him. You may feel inferior. You may battle loneliness. You may battle discouragement. You may feel inadequate to serve God or to be used by God. And I tell you this morning, that is great. That's wonderful. Because then God will be your sufficiency. God will be your strength. When you are weak, then you are strong. The secret is absolute surrender. You have longed for sweet peace and for faith to increase. And you've earnestly, fervently prayed. But you cannot have rest or be perfectly blessed until all on the altar is laid. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart, does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield Him your body and soul. I want to close and give you, there's four responses you're going to have to this message. Listen carefully, everybody look this way. There's four responses you're going to have to this message this morning. The first response, the first group of people are going to be what I call the cop-outs. You know what they are? God's not going to use me. You've already determined, you've already believed the lie of Satan and you've bought into it, so you're not going to set any goals. You're not going to, you're just going to say, okay, that was a nice message, preacher. See you later. And you cop out. Then there's the second group. They're the holdouts. I don't know if God will use me, you'd say, but I'm afraid to commit myself to Him. You're fearful. You'd rather, though you're not, you don't really like where you are, but at least you know what that is. There's a certain comfort level with that. If you surrender to God, it's an unknown. So you hold out. Then there's the dropouts. I'm talking to people in the room who, You started to surrender once, but things got tough. Things got hard. And so you got discouraged and you quit. And you think now, I can't go back there. That's a lie of the devil. You can go back. But I hope there'll be some people this morning, and I pray there'll be people who will be the all-outs. The all-outs. What are those people? Ones who will surrender completely to God for God to use them. They'll pray the price to be used by God, and they'll see God do wonderful and miraculous things with their life. Who does God use? Ordinary people. Ordinary people. What hinders you? Is it your past? Is it your present circumstances? Is it your weaknesses? Is it a lack of surrender? Why don't you just surrender? Hey, God may have you do just exactly what you're doing, but listen to me. God wants a surrendered vessel this morning. I don't know what God has for you to do, but I know this. Everybody ought to find out. And the way you find out is, you bow the knee to Him and say, Lord, I just want You to know I'm surrendered. Whatever You want to do with my life, I'll do it. I'll do it. Not going to let my past hinder me. Not going to let my present circumstances hinder me. Not let any weaknesses in my life hinder me. God only has crooked sticks to use. So why not be like Isaiah and say, here am I, Lord. Send me. Surrender to Him. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank you for everyone's attention today. Lord, thank you for putting your hand upon the Apostle Paul, saving his soul, and then touching his life to serve you. And Lord, I'm thankful that he didn't let the past or his present circumstances or his own weakness, physical weaknesses or personal weaknesses, hinder him from doing what you wanted him to do. And Lord, today I'm asking you that you would touch the hearts of people in this room, that they would not cop out or hold out or drop out, but they would say, God, I'm all out for you. And yield themselves completely, absolute surrender to God. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer in just a moment. I wonder how many folks in the room today would say, Pastor, you know, you talked about coming to Jesus like Saul came to Jesus on the road to Damascus, and there's only one way to heaven, that's through Jesus Christ. And I wonder today if you've had that moment when you know that Jesus Christ became real to you. You understood you were a sinner who needed a Savior and that Jesus was the Savior you needed. And you put your faith and trust in Jesus as your Savior. And if that's you this morning, you say, Pastor, I know that I'm saved. I know Jesus is my Savior. Here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip it up for a moment that I could see it and say, Pastor, I know that I'm saved. God bless you. Amen. You may put them down. You're here today and would say, Pastor, I'm not sure that if I'm saved or not. I can't say that for sure. Would you let me pray for you? I'm not going to embarrass you. We're not going to call you out. But I certainly would pray for you that you would settle that matter. You say, Pastor, pray for me today. I don't know that I've ever truly accepted Christ as my Savior. Pray for me this morning. Would you slip it up and back down that I could see it? Is there someone like that today? Okay. The message was to believers this morning. Can God use me? I think you got the answer, didn't you? He sure can. You remove the obstacles. There is no obstacles there. God forgives the past. He'll help you overcome any present circumstances. He helps you to overcome any personal weaknesses. All you need to do is absolutely surrender to Him. All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily live. That's what you say to God. You're here this morning would say, Pastor, God stopped at my heart today. He's pricked my heart this morning. And if God will use me, I sure want to be used by Him. And I will surrender for Him to use me this morning. Pastor, here's my hand. God has spoken to me today. Will you slip it up, Christian? God bless you. Amen. 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 Wonderful. You may put him down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. The invitation is time for you to just come and bow the knee and respond to what God's told you to do in your heart. Humble yourself before Him. Surrender. The altar is a good place for surrender. Surrender yourself to the Lord this morning. If you're today and you're saved and you've never been scripturally baptized, you ought to come and say, you know, Pastor, I'm saved, but I've not been baptized since I've been saved. That's the next step you should take. If you're saved and you've been scripturally baptized, you believe this is where you ought to belong, then you come and say, Pastor, we need to belong. We need to have a place to serve. This is a place. Christian, just need to come and bow and kneel and talk to the Lord. You do that. Father, thank you for speaking to our hearts this morning. Now, Father, I pray that you'll meet with us as we bow our knee and call out to thee. Lord, the ones this morning that will completely surrender to you. Oh God, use them. Use them in a great way to touch hearts and touch lives for Jesus Christ. To be used of God. What a wonderful, wonderful thing. So have your way in every heart and life, please, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing the invitation. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to him this morning, will you?
Oh, that's right. Jesus, I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him, in his presence daily live. I surrender all, I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Jesus, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, humbly at his feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all, I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, make me Savior wholly thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. I surrender all, I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, Lord, I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power. Let thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all, I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Go ahead and be seated for a minute if you would. You know, a few of you were at the service Friday for Vicki. And, you know, I thought about Brother Currington, Brother Bob, when he talks about how many people you think would be at your funeral. I thought about that Friday. And there's a woman who, you know, you think she's just living in South part of, I guess that's still considered Grove City, and it's in a trailer park and not much of this world's goods at all. And you think, what kind of influence does she have? But there was a full house there Friday, and I'm sure many more that could have been there if it weren't for other obligations. And just thought about her influence that she's had. You have no idea the influence. See, if you can't die without it affecting 50, 75, 100, 200 people, you can't live without affecting 50, 75, 100, 200 people. You have an influence. Use it for God. You know, you ever think what conversation Stephen must have had with the Lord in heaven as he saw Saul get saved? Huh? And the Lord looks down and says, see, that's why you died when you did. That's why I had you do what you did. And look, because of you were ready, you were faithful unto death, look at what happened. Look at what happened. Amazing. God will use you, but you have to be yielded to Him. You have to surrender. God will use you. We have a name here. Thank you. Yeah, I know. Okay. Ricky Carter is coming. And Ricky has been saved and baptized as a teenager, and she's coming for membership this morning in the church. And, of course, now, Tevin, she was baptized here. I remember baptizing her. And so was Lydia. Weren't you, Lydia? Okay. And so they're already members. And the other little girl is saved but hasn't been baptized yet. So we'll wait on her to be follow the Lord in baptism. But we're glad to have Ricky and the girls coming to be part of our church, and we're thankful. All those who would like to vote Ricky Carter in to be a member of the church, let it be known by a hearty aye,
aye,
and opposed by like sign. All right. Congratulations, Ricky. Good to have you. Glad you're here, and looking forward to serving the Lord with you. Amen. All right. Well, let's stand together. We'll have a word of prayer. We'll sing our song of dismissal. Come back tonight, will you? 6:30. It is the Lord's day, not just the Lord's morning, all right? And come back tonight. How do you handle stumbling blocks? I think it'll be a help to you tonight, all right? Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the good service today and for decisions that were made for you. Thank you for meeting with us. Thank you for being our God. We love you this morning, Lord, and we pray that you'll make us mindful that you go with us now as we leave this place. And Father, our prayers, we bow before you, is that you would use us. As we even, if we go to the restaurant today, if you people we cross paths with, maybe at a grocery store, Lord, whatever it is in the neighborhood, make us mindful that you want to use us to influence others for Christ. Help us be like those lepers we studied in Sunday school that had to tell somebody else about the blessings that they've received. And so, Lord, use us this day, and then bring us back for our service this evening. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Brother Bob?
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family, the family of God. Amen. You're dismissed. We'll see you tonight.